Ben Franklin's World is a production of the Omohundro Institute. Hello, and welcome to episode 258 of Ben Franklin's World, the podcast dedicated to helping you learn more about how the people and events of our early American past have shaped the present-day world we live in. And I'm your host, Liz Covart. Have you ever looked at the journals for the Continental Congress and explored the vote for independence? It's actually quite fascinating. The Second Continental Congress voted for independence on July 2, 1776, with 12 colonies voting in favor for independence and one abstaining from the vote. Now, the abstention came from the New York delegation. The New York delegates felt they lacked permission to vote on the subject from the New York Provincial Congress, so they opted not to vote on July 2nd. Instead, they waited until they had permission to vote and then voted in favor for independence on July 9. And that brings us to Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania was able to vote in favor for independence and do so unanimously because two of its delegates who were opposed to the matter were persuaded not to attend the vote. And one of those two delegates was John Dickinson. Dickinson not only absented himself from the vote, but later, he would refuse to sign the Declaration of Independence. But why? Jane Calvert, an associate professor of history at the University of Kentucky, and the director and editor of the John Dickinson Writings Project, joins us to explore the life, religion, and political views of John Dickinson. Now, during our conversation, Jane reveals information about John Dickinson's Quaker upbringing and education, details about how Dickinson's Quaker upbringing and education informed his politics and fueled his desire to help common people, and what John Dickinson's politics really were, and why America's first international political celebrity refused to vote for independence. But first, I'll be in Atlanta next week, and I'm really excited about it. I have never been to Atlanta before. Well, not unless you count the airports, then I've been there several times, but I never count the airports. That's not really visiting a place. So I'm going to Atlanta, I'm going to visit, and while I'm in town, I'm going to host a meetup on Saturday, October 12th at 4 p.m. at the Atkins Park Restaurant on North Highland Avenue. I really can't wait for this meetup. All these meetups are a lot of fun, and you know what? To each and every meetup, I bring some of the podcast's famous rubber bookmarks, so if you want some free Ben Franklin's World swag and you're in Atlanta, you should come to this event, because we're going to have a lot of fun. Now, you'll find the details that you need for this Atlanta meetup at benfranklinsworld.com/meetup. And also, while you're there, please RSVP so I know how many people to look out for. Again, that's benfranklinsworld.com/meetup. Okay, are you ready to meet the real John Dickinson and the foremost scholar of his life? Without further ado, allow me to introduce you to Jane Calvert. Joining us is an associate professor of history at the University of Kentucky and the director and editor of the John Dickinson Writings Project. Her research interests are in early modern Anglo-American religion and political theory, on which she's written numerous articles and a book, Quaker Constitutionalism and the Political Thought of John Dickinson, which is the first book in a trilogy of works about John Dickinson. Welcome back to Ben Franklin's World, Jane Calvert.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Jane, it's great to have you back on the show. Now, the last time we spoke was in episode 153, when we explored the different committees and congresses of the American Revolution. And I know during our conversation, John Dickinson came up, but we also really didn't have time to explore his life. But that's something we do have today, is time to explore John Dickinson's life. So could we start with a quick overview of John Dickinson's life and have you give us some context for who he was and why we should really dig further into the details of his life?
John Dickinson was America's first international political celebrity. He was considered around the Atlantic world as the spokesman for the American resistance to Britain. He also wrote more for the American cause than any other figure, including more of the official documents from the constituted bodies, from the Stamp Act all the way up through the Annapolis Convention. And he wrote more to ordinary Americans in order to educate them about the situation and about their rights and to encourage them to speak up regardless of their station in life. So he was also the only leading figure who was actually present in America from the beginning of the founding era all the way through the early Republic. Unlike the other leading figures, he never went abroad for long periods of time. So always there on the scene, holding public offices and advocating American rights.
It's really fascinating to me that Dickinson always seemed to be writing for common people and not just for his peers.
Yeah, it really is a striking aspect of his life that he felt compelled to educate ordinary Americans specifically on, you know, his areas of expertise, which were the law and politics. He took great care to make sure that ordinary people understood the issues, and not just that they understood the issues, that they were able to participate. So a lot of leaders kind of paid lip service to, you know, speaking to the ordinary people, but Dickinson actually took care to simplify the issues without sort of dumbing them down, but simplifying them so that ordinary working people could understand what was going on. And this was a refrain that stretched throughout his career. So for example, writing as the Pennsylvania farmer in 1767-68, in the opening farmer's letter, he said, "As a charitable but poor person does not withhold his mite because he cannot relieve all the distresses of the miserable, so let not any honest man suppress his sentiments concerning freedom, however small their influence is likely to be. Perhaps he may touch some wheel that will have an effect greater than he expects." And then 20 years later, writing to advocate the ratification of the Constitution, he said, "What concerns all should be considered by all, and individuals may injure a whole society by not declaring their sentiments. It is therefore not only their right, but their duty to declare them." And he took the same approach in law to educate ordinary people about how to write a will, for example, and how to advocate for their rights. So yeah, this is a striking aspect of his career.
And now I'm even more fascinated by this aspect of Dickinson because it really does sound exceptional. Do you know how and why Dickinson made the decision to write so that everyone could better understand the law and politics of the day and about their rights?
I'm inclined to think that it's rooted in his Quakerism. And that's not to say that he was a Quaker. He actually never formally affiliated with any religious group, but he was raised by Quaker parents. He practiced law and politics in Quaker Philadelphia. And I think he just adopted the kind of, you know, compassion that Quakers had for subordinated peoples, the people who were oppressed, downtrodden, persecuted. And so, you know, he went to law school with the specific goal of helping poor people and distressed people. He said, "When I reflect on the end and intent of my profession and my particular designs in it, I find no consideration of equal weight with defending the innocent and redressing the injured. That seems to be the noblest aim of human abilities and industry." So this is when he was just in his early 20s, and he took this concern and acted on it for the rest of his life.
You know, when we think about people today who want to help the poor and less fortunate, we often think that there might be something in their background that causes them to make that choice, that they themselves experienced poverty and hardship, and now they want to make a difference. Was this the case for John Dickinson? Was there something in his early experiences or background that drove him in the direction of wanting to help those less fortunate?
Actually, he was among the privileged class. His father was a landowner. He had extensive properties in Maryland and Delaware, and he was a lawyer and a judge. His mother came from a well-to-do Quaker family, and she herself was highly educated, and he had every advantage. He knew exactly that he was privileged, and he had sympathy for, even pity for, people who did not have education and could never have the advantages that he had in life. So he felt obligated to use his advantages, his education, his wealth, his library, to help others possibly raise up closer to where he was. So yeah, this is not necessarily common in the early American landscape.
Now, Sarah wonders about Dickinson's earliest and most influential teachers. So would you tell us about those teachers and what roles they may have played in helping Dickinson develop his compassion and passion for helping others?
Yeah, so I think they were really his parents. He was an extraordinarily devoted son. His parents were a little older, and before he was born, three of his elder brothers had already died. Two of them died in London. I think they went over for legal education. And the other one died just abroad. We don't know, but I kind of assume he was also in London. So he'd lost three brothers, and his parents were really very anxious for him. And so he understood that they worried about him, and he was devoted to them, and making good on the money and effort that they put into raising him and to educating him. So he started out being educated at home, but his family was wealthy enough for him to have tutors. And he had possibly three tutors. The first one, we don't know much about him. He might have been tutored by a fellow named James Orr. I have not been able to find much about him. Then he was probably also tutored by Francis Allenson, who became known as an old side Presbyterian minister. And then his last tutor was William Killen, also a Presbyterian, an Irish-born Presbyterian, who became the Chief Justice of Delaware after the Revolution. And then he read law with John Moland, who was a king's attorney in Philadelphia. But also his parents. We don't have a lot of records, or really almost any records, from his childhood or his teenage years. But it's very clear that it's partially, you know, nature and nurture, that he had this education from Quaker parents and these very well-educated scholars who came into his household to tutor him. But he was also a very just deeply passionate person who felt compelled to do right in the world. So the Quakerism, I think, just fed into this and helped guide his passions.
You mentioned that Dickinson's earliest and most influential teachers were actually his parents. And John Dickinson's mother, Mary Cadwallader, seems to be a really interesting figure because I heard, or perhaps really what I did is I read it somewhere, but I have heard or read that Mary Cadwallader was not only really well educated, but she read law for herself. So could you tell us more about Dickinson's mother, Mary Cadwallader, and about her relationship with her son?
We don't know much about her early years. We know that she was born in Marion, Pennsylvania, to Quaker parents. And her father was a school teacher. When she was around five, they moved to Philadelphia and he became a merchant. We don't know how she met Dickinson's father, Samuel Dickinson. He was living in Maryland at the time, but the world was small. And so they met and married and they had several children. Dickinson was the first. And then the only other living brother he had, full brother, was Philemon Dickinson. Mary was a devout Quaker, but not sort of one of the strictest Quakers. And we know that she read law. She read law books, at least when Dickinson went to law school. There's not a lot of evidence, but in a letter that he wrote to his father, and we have a wonderful body of letters, most of the letters that Dickinson wrote to his parents when he was in London for law school, we have those, but unfortunately, we do not have the letters that they sent to him. So apparently his father must have written a letter to him explaining that his mother had taken up reading law books with his father. So Dickinson wrote to his father, he was talking about how too many lawyers in Kent County in Delaware. And then he said, I was very much diverted with my honored mother's designing to add to the students of this profession by reading law books. And then he yearned to come home so he could read law books with his parents. So this was, not an ordinary pursuit that women of the time would take on. Law books they're not like novels. They're not exactly light or fun reading. So this was an extraordinary task that she took on herself.
So if Mary was interested in and engaging with the law by reading her husband's law books, did she also have an interest in politics? Did she have any political views that she shared with her husband and sons?
Well, I'm sure she did have her political views. We know this because some of Dickinson's colleagues in Congress, notably John Adams, were really unhappy that both his wife and his mother expressed their political views to him. We also know from letters that Dickinson wrote to her that he talked about everything with her. He talked about his aspirations in life. He talked about love and marriage. He talked about, just family events. But he also, especially after his father died in 1760, he did write to her about his political activities and about current events, but we don't have a lot back from her about her views. I think it's pretty safe to assume that she and her son thought the same way about politics.
From our conversation thus far, it seems like to get at and better understand John Dickinson, we really need to look at both his family and his legal and political career. So would you tell us more about Dickinson's legal training and about the type of political career he pursued?
After he read law in Philadelphia with John Molin, the king's attorney, his parents had enough money to send him to the Middle Temple, which is part of the Inns of Court in London. Now, the Inns of Court was where lawyers, attorneys, barristers, solicitors went to be trained. Very few Americans had the means to go over and spend 3 or 4 years in London. It was very expensive. It was very arduous. We know from Dickinson's family history that young men went over there and they died because of illnesses, the hardships that they endured. So this was a rare privilege. So Dickinson went over there with the intent of studying diligently and only sort of sampling the excitements and the opportunities that the big city of London had to offer. We know he went to the theater. We know he did go out with friends sometimes, but he made sure that he was always virtuous and doing right by his parents. And he did not spend his time drinking in the public houses and spending too much time at the theater and socializing. He had a strict schedule of getting up very early, doing his studies and going to Westminster Hall and, you know, attending the court cases and passing his exams and working on acquiring legal knowledge for the purpose of advocating for, as he put it, the innocent and the injured. So then when he came back to Philadelphia, he really tried to put his theories into practice. And he was especially concerned with equity and making sure that all people could be represented fairly, equitably under the law. So Pennsylvania did not have what England had, which was a court of chancery. A court of chancery was just a court of equity. A court of equity was to expedite cases and soften the common law. And Dickinson took this very seriously. So he thought that although Pennsylvania didn't have specifically a court of chancery, he expressed to his parents that he believed that really all courts in Pennsylvania were courts of chancery, courts of equity. And so the way he saw it, the court of chancery removes the rough hand of violence too often supported by the law and affords a healing plaster or bandage to those poor wretches who have been torn by the thorns and briars of the law. So he took it upon himself to represent poor people, people who were maybe unfairly accused or would not, for some reason, be able to get a fair trial. He was what we would call today sort of an estate lawyer. He concerned himself with property. He pursued a lot of cases of debt and helped people with wills and then interpreted wills. That was sort of his main practice. But then he took other cases on the side because there weren't that many lawyers in Philadelphia. And so lawyers had to kind of do all kinds of law. So he took on criminal cases and frequently took cases of people who had been accused of really, truly heinous crimes. So murder, for example, infanticide. He took on cases of poor men, poor women, and even cases of mixed race people or African Americans who had been accused of heinous crimes. For example, there is a case, Dominus Rex versus Rachel Francisco. This was a case in Delaware. And so Rachel Francisco was a poor servant woman, and she was mixed race, and she was accused of infanticide and concealment. So she had a baby out of wedlock and then killed it and concealed it. And Dickinson took this case on. This was not something that he had to do. It was likely that he took cases like this pro bono, although the records are pretty sparse. So he took on this case with the intent that this woman needed a fair trial. So he started out his notes for the court. He said, "Women have suffered, no doubt, for the concealment of a dead child." And this was a harsh statute. the concealment statute that she was being tried under would have meant the death penalty had she been convicted. So at this point, it was, I believe, 1768 when he took this case on. And at this point, Dickinson was internationally famous, or was about to be internationally famous, for his farmer's letters. Yet he took on this case representing this mixed-race servant woman who was accused of having a child out of wedlock, killing it, and then concealing it. And this could well have damaged his reputation, which is why most men did not want to be involved with cases that concerned women's issues, specifically reproduction. He also frequently, in his notes to the court for these cases, made sure that people knew that he would not take on a case if he believed the person to be guilty. So he made sure that he could ascertain definitively that the person he was representing was innocent. Otherwise, he wouldn't take the case. For example, he said, "God forbid that the desire for gain," and then he crossed that out and put, "the pursuits of my profession." So even then, lawyers were suspected of taking cases just for monetary gain. So, "God forbid that the pursuits of my profession should ever tempt me to disguise the blackest crimes or to endeavor to prevent the punishment due to their guilt. As I never have, so I never will receive the least reward for appearing on such an occasion as this," this was a murder case, "that I may ever preserve those two invaluable blessings, the approbation of my own conscience and a character unspotted with the sordid love of gain." So this was someone who talked about, you know, adhering inflexibly to his principles. And this went for his legal practice as well as his political activities.
Yeah, wow. It really sounds like Dickinson was guided by a strong moral compass, in that he really would only take on cases where he thought he represented the right side, and in his decision that he was going to stand up for women and people of color when they needed it. Now, was this compass a manifestation of the Quakerism his parents educated him with, or did this compass also come from another source later in his life?
It's hard to think that it didn't play a role. Quakers were the only religious group that not just allowed women to preach, but also to become ministers and to travel without a male chaperone. Quakers believed that men and women were spiritually equal. There is a reason that William Penn talked about the equality of men and women in marriage, and that Pennsylvania was the only colony that was run by a woman, Hannah Penn, after Penn died. So when Quakers thought that women were spiritually equal, that didn't always necessarily translate into, you know, political or civil equality. I would say that it generally didn't. But women were seen as capable of more than what non-Quaker men believed women should do. So, for example, John Adams believed that women should not engage in discussion of politics, whereas Dickinson, he encouraged women such as Catherine McCulley and Mercy Otis Warren to write about politics and to try to persuade people of what he knew was virtuous, what was right. And Quaker women routinely owned property and managed property effectively. So, for example, Dickinson's wife, Mary Norris, before she married John Dickinson, she controlled a very large and complicated estate, her father's estate, Fairhill. There was a huge manor house, an extensive library, and lots of tenant properties. And Mary controlled this and managed it with the help of her female relatives, with actually very little to no oversight by her male Quaker relatives.
You know, hearing about Dickinson's wife, Mary Norris, and his mother, Mary Cadwallader, it just sounds like Dickinson had this propensity to surround himself with these very intelligent, very capable women. And it really does seem like these women played an important role in Dickinson's politics. So would you tell us more about his wife, Mary Norris, and the role she played or may have played in his politics?
It's hard to know exactly when Dickinson met Mary Norris. He was serving in the Pennsylvania Assembly in the early 1760s with Mary's father, Isaac Norris. Although he and Isaac Norris were not on the same page politically at every point. It's clear that Dickinson made trips out to Fairhill, the estate where Isaac Norris lived with his two daughters, and he would have known her starting in the early to mid 1760s. So then Isaac Norris died in 1766. And at that point, at least, I think Dickinson began spending more time, and he became friends with Mary and her younger sister, Sally. And at that point, the two sisters lived at Fairhill with their aunt, Elizabeth Norris, and their cousins, Mary and Hannah Griffiths. And what they did was they managed the tenant properties and the estate of Fairhill, and they wrote poetry. And so it was kind of a Quaker sorority. They had very little male influence in their lives. And Dickinson was friends with the sisters and would spend time there. And at some point towards 1768, 69, it's clear that Dickinson had fallen in love with Mary Norris and wanted to get married. But she wasn't interested, at least not enough to leave this sort of literary sorority and give that up for a man. But then tragedy hit the household and Sally Norris died of the smallpox and Mary was bereft. I think that's what changed her mind. My sense is that with not much evidence to go on, my sense is that managing the property was just something she didn't want to do anymore. And she finally relented and agreed to marry John. But she wanted a Quaker wedding. She wanted to get married under the care of friends. And he could not do that. He did not want to get married under the care of friends. And so he begged her to reconsider and kind of subtly accused her of being overly influenced by the Quakers, that she should be happy enough with the civil laws and a civil ceremony, and that that should be enough. And you know, she shouldn't be overly influenced by the rules of a private set of men. So she finally relented and they got married in a civil ceremony. She was disciplined by the meeting. She was reprimanded by her meeting. She wasn't disowned by the Quakers, but she must have shown some contrition for getting married outside of the Quaker fold. And then something remarkable happened. Dickinson simply moved into the sorority. He moved in with Mary to Fairhill and lived there with her maiden aunt and two maiden cousins for the first 3 years of their marriage. The female relatives only moved out after they had their first child, Sally Norris. And so here he was, submerged in this world of female Quaker poets. He was also friends with Susanna Wright, who owned Wright's Ferry. So this woman was not just a landowner, a ferry operator, she was a physician, she was a poet, and she wrote feminist poetry. Dickinson was also friends with Elizabeth Graham, who became Elizabeth Graham Ferguson, a literary light of Philadelphia. So he was submerged in this world, and we don't have a lot of information. We have a little bit of the poetry from these women remains. One of them is quite striking. It was a poem that Mary wrote. It had to be to Dickinson. It was addressed to a young gentleman. It was giving this young gentleman advice on more or less managing his fame and making sure that he took religion into account and did not let his fame go to his head. And so just a few lines of this give you a sense of the sort of tone of the advice that Mary gave to her husband. She said, "First, fire religion's empire in your soul, put every passion under her control. And when religion laid the perfect plan, join education to complete the man. Let strict politeness make the diamond glow, and brave humanity that melts at woe teach you to aid the poor man's friendless cause." So that just sounds very much like the impulse that drove Dickinson to go to law school and practice law to help ordinary people defend their rights. And so I think Mary, who was a stricter Quaker than John Dickinson's mother, I think the two of them, they exerted influence on him. But I don't know that they pushed him in a direction that he wasn't already headed. So in his politics, before he got married in 1770, he was already advocating peaceful resistance to British oppression. And I think his wife and his mother just reinforced that conviction that he already had and counseled him to stay true to his principles when he was being pressured by his colleagues in the First and Second Continental Congresses. He was being pressured to relent and to support violent resistance. And his colleagues knew that his wife and his mother were there in the background, encouraging him to stay strong to his principles. And so they sought to undermine that influence. It rubbed them the wrong way that he would allow his wife and his mother to influence him the way they did. John Adams actually said, "If I had such a wife and such a mother, I should have shot myself." But Dickinson clearly did not mind, was willing to accept the counsel of strong women, and he stuck to his peaceful principles right up until he knew that the Declaration of Independence was going to pass. So he refused to vote on it. He refused to sign it. But then he felt obliged to support the cause of his country. He was not ultimately a Quaker. And so he took up arms and went to meet the British. He had founded the 1st Philadelphia Battalion of Associators. He was the colonel of that unit. And he went to the front to meet the British days after he refused to sign the Declaration of Independence. And then later, despite being one of the wealthiest and most, you know, famous men in the Delaware Valley, he enlisted in the Delaware militia as a private and served at the Battle of Brandywine. So he was a Quaker fellow traveler, but not a Quaker, and very strongly influenced by the Quakerism of his wife and his mother.
So last summer, Jane and I were at a conference where we had a nice long chat about John Dickinson. And during our conversation, Jane made the case that, unlike John Adams, we really could and should view John Dickinson as a feminist. So Jane, could you catch us all up to speed on that discussion and tell us what it would have meant to be a feminist in the 18th century and why you think we should view John Dickinson as an 18th century feminist?
Yeah, we need to be really careful about anachronism, because it's all too easy to take ideas that we have now and impose them on people of the time. We should not make the mistake of thinking that Dickinson was a liberal or a progressive as we understand that today. It's tempting, but it would not be true to who he was. That said, I've tried to think very carefully about whether that term can be applied to Dickinson and how we would apply it. And I think if we keep it very narrow and think of it within the confines of the 18th century, I think we can use that word cautiously and advisedly. So to be a feminist in the 18th century, I think meant little more than recognizing that women had rights that were worthy of protection. And these rights were the same rights that men had. Now, that does not mean that Dickinson believed, for example, that a woman should hold office. There's no evidence that he thought that. I don't have any evidence at this point that he advocated the right of women to vote. The most significant thing that I've seen is actually quite revolutionary, and I use that word intentionally. So in his draft of the Articles of Confederation that he wrote 3 weeks before the Declaration of Independence, the third clause, it's one of the longest clauses in his draft, and it was a clause for protection of liberty of conscience. And when he wrote this, I found in his papers the draft of this clause, and it's striking. It goes like this. He wrote, "No person or persons in any colony living peaceably under the civil government shall be molested or prejudiced in his or their." Then he stopped and he crossed out "his or their" and inserted "his or her persons or estate for his or her religious persuasion or practice." This is revolutionary because it's the first time, I believe, that gender-inclusive language was used in a constitution in a fundamental law. So this is a fundamental right, liberty of conscience, that he believed should be protected for men and explicitly women. But more than that, this language that he used is really important. He said, no person shall be molested or prejudiced in his or her persons or estate for his or her religious persuasion or practice. That word practice was key because Dickinson knew that the way Quaker women practiced their religion was by public preaching. So when he did this, he was not just protecting a woman's right to liberty of conscience, but also her right to freedom of public speech. This was a right that most women in the early modern world would not even consider that they had, let alone that it should be protected in a written constitution. So this is where I find it's accurate to call Dickinson an early feminist. Beyond that, he advocated women writing on politics, publishing on politics, and he also was concerned that women specifically be held up as examples of strength and virtue. And so he wanted books about women, biographies of strong and eminent women. He wanted these books published so that people could read and follow their example. And what's interesting is that, you know, Quakers had long held women up as examples of piety and religious virtue. But Dickinson made it clear that it wasn't just about their religion or just about God speaking through them, but about the women themselves and their own strength. He and Mary had five children. Only two daughters survived. Those daughters were his inspiration and his guides and his confidants. He treasured his relationship with them. So there is just this whole world that Dickinson lived in that was shaped by women. And of course, a concern for their rights would have to come through in his life and his work on rights that took place over the course of his whole life.
I'd like to talk a little bit more about the Articles of Confederation, because Dickinson's inclusion of women in his first draft of that Constitution wasn't his only radical or revolutionary idea. Dickinson also included an anti-slavery clause or a question about such a clause in his first draft. So after we take a moment to talk about our episode sponsor, Jane, I wonder if you would tell us what happened when Dickinson submitted his first draft of that Constitution to the Second Continental Congress. Did you know that socks are the number one most requested clothing item in homeless shelters? Well, Bombas is on a mission to change that. Bombas has created the most comfortable socks in the history of feet, and for every pair of socks purchased, Bombas donates a pair to someone in need. Now, these aren't just any socks. Bombas has designed their socks with special comfort innovations, colors, patterns, lengths, and styles, so that Bombas socks are really perfect for the whole family. In fact, get your hands on a pair of Bombas socks, and your feet will thank you. Now to date, Bombas has donated over 20 million pairs of socks to people in need, and Bombas socks are made with super soft natural cotton, and every pair is designed with arch support, a seamless toe, and a cushioned footbed that's supportive, but not too thick. Now, my new favorite Bombas socks are their new Merino wool socks, which are designed to be breathable, dry, and never itchy, and they have just the right amount of thickness, too. With tons of different colors, patterns, lengths, and styles, Bombas socks really make the perfect gift for everyone on your list. Now, I've been a happy wearer of Bombas socks for 2 years now. I love to wear the colorful ankle socks with my sneakers, the more dressy Merino wool socks with my work shoes, and I found the Bombas performance ski and snowboard socks make for a really comfortable day in my ski boots or in my ice skates. Plus, I really love the mission. Every day I walk around Boston, I see people in need. It's really hard not to be able to stop and help everyone. So Tim and I regularly support our local homeless shelters, and we're always looking for other ways that we can help our neighbors. And one of the small ways we found that we can help our neighbors is to support companies like Bombas that have the mission to help out too. You can save 20% on your first order of Bombas when you shop at bombas.com/BFWorld. That's bombas.com/BFWorld to save 20%. Bombas.com /BFWorld. Jane, would you tell us what happened when John Dickinson submitted his first draft of the Articles of Confederation to the Second Continental Congress? What exactly did these other congressmen think when they received this draft constitution that included language for women and against slavery?
So there actually wasn't an anti-slavery clause. He queried on a draft whether there should be one. I think it's completely safe to assume that he thought there should be one, and this was just sort of a question to prompt his colleagues to consider it, because he had already started writing against slavery, and not just writing against slavery, because that was actually relatively sparse. He didn't write extensively against slavery, but he was proposing a law for Pennsylvania prohibiting slavery. And in 1777, he began the process of freeing all of his own slaves. So first, he manumitted all of his slaves conditionally in 1777. And then in 1781, he couldn't live with gradually manumitting his slaves or conditionally manumitting them. And he finally freed them all. And as of 1786, he owned no more slaves. And he took a financial hit of, he estimated, around 10,000 pounds, which is quite a bit of money. And of course, also lost labor. And then throughout the rest of his life, he effectively paid reparations to his former slaves by providing for their basic needs for the remainder of their lives. And he was especially concerned with the widows. But even after one of his female slaves got married, he still continued to provide her with basic necessities. And he charged them little or no rent to live on his properties and work the land and take resources from them. So this query that he put on the Articles of Confederation was really a prompt that his colleagues just dismissed. Another key feature of his draft of the Articles of Confederation was a provision for a strong central government, that the states would be subordinate to this strong central government. Unfortunately, we do not have records from the drafting committee. We only have his notes. The only other little snippet we have is one of his colleagues on the drafting committee complained about Dickinson's vice of, quote unquote, refining too much, as though you can refine a constitution for a new country too much. But they were irritated with him, wanted to move on. And when his colleagues received this draft, and Dickinson by that time had left to join his battalion in New Jersey, they excised everything. They took out the religious liberty clause. They took out the clause protecting Native Americans. They took out the clause about the strong central government, and then rewrote the Articles of Confederation in 1777 to make it into the quote-unquote imbecile document that we know today and was ratified in 1781.
So we've really talked a lot about John Dickinson and about the women in his life and about his views on slavery, religion, women, the law, politics. Jane, when you look at all of this, what do you make of the legacy of John Dickinson? And do you think his legacy is where it should stand today?
No. Probably saw that answer coming. Dickinson has been sort of the victim of historiography and historical circumstances. He has been something of an enigma to historians. They haven't been able to understand why or how he could be the leader of the resistance to Britain and then subsequently refuse to vote on or sign the Declaration of Independence. And the reason that they've been confused is that they've been reading the present back into the past and assuming that Dickinson wanted revolution and independence from the beginning, when his own words say specifically that that is not what he wanted, that he wanted the colonies to stay within the British Empire under the protection of the British Constitution, because he believed it was the best safeguard for their rights would be under the British Constitution. So the most extreme form of protest that he wanted Americans to engage in was civil disobedience, which was a technique pioneered by Quakers during severe times of persecution in England and America. And this civil disobedience did no violence to persons or properties, and it tried to change the law from the bottom up and preserve the unity of the polity. And a compelling reason for why Dickinson would have thought Americans' rights would be better preserved under the British Constitution was the recent 1772 court case of Somerset v. Stuart, which found that chattel slavery was incompatible with the common law. And so I think Dickinson was looking at this just as Southern slaveholders were looking at this. And he was hoping, and they were concerned, that if in Britain slavery was determined to be incompatible with the common law, that could mean the beginning of abolition in America. So historians have been confused, or just when they didn't understand him, especially during the kind of Whiggish historiography of the early 19th century. And this is a time when the Declaration of Independence had been raised to this kind of sacred document that we consider it to be today. And all they had to do was look and say, oh, well, Dickinson, he was not in favor of the Declaration of Independence. And so they could cast him as a loyalist foil, an unpatriotic foil to heroes such as John Adams. And so he was more or less eviscerated by historians like Bancroft. And then combine that negative historiography with the fact that Dickinson's papers have been unavailable. They have been either scattered throughout the country, not cataloged well, or they've just been illegible. So no one could get into his papers, really access them, and see what he had to say for himself. So my project, the John Dickinson Writings Project, is in the process of collecting, transcribing, editing, annotating all of these papers and showing who he was and what he believed in. And so I'm hoping it's going to open a whole new field of Dickinson studies, and we can get rid of these really disparaging portrayals, such as, you know, 1776, where he's portrayed as the cool conservative man and sort of dancing across the stage, always to the right, never to the left, or the equally inaccurate picture in the John Adams HBO miniseries, where Dickinson is just this sort of, you know, sour-faced, negative-minded, barely patriotic person, and is really almost out to sabotage the American cause. This all needs to go away. And hopefully, when Dickinson's writings are available to the public in both print and digital editions, scholars and the public will be able to get in there and see what Dickinson had to say for himself. And at this point in our history, Americans are really yearning for a virtuous leader, someone that they can look up to and follow. And that's difficult when, as we've looked deeper into our leaders and we've found some really tragic flaws, you know, slavery and misogyny and elitism. And it's hard to reconcile what we see as some very fundamental contradictions with American values. And I think Dickinson can fulfill that role. Not that he was perfect. He certainly had his shortcomings and his challenges, but he at least always tried to work according to his principles, which come closer to modern American sensibilities than a lot else that was going on in early America. So I think Dickinson could be very useful for us now, and I hope people will give him a second or a first look.
We should jump into the time warp. This is the fun segment of the show where we ask you a hypothetical history question about what might have happened if something had occurred differently, or if someone had acted differently. Jane, in your opinion, what might have happened if John Dickinson had remained a bachelor? If he hadn't met and married Mary Norris and formed relationships with her female relatives, what would John Dickinson's politics have looked like?
That's an interesting question. I'm inclined to think that Dickinson's wife and his daughters and his circle of female friends, they didn't so much change him drastically as they did reinforce and enhance the person he already was. I think they allowed him to be himself more fully and more confidently. And I think he probably became a more deeply religious person because of them. We see a shift in Dickinson's overall demeanor around the time of the Revolutionary War, when he was battered by patriots on the one side and the British on the other, and his properties were burned and looted, and he was libeled in the press. And it was a very difficult time for him. And I think he retreated only temporarily, but retreated into the arms of his wife and his daughters, and found religion much more deeply than he had before. And he actually himself gave credit to his older daughter for convincing him to become much more Quakerly than he was. I'm not sure that this is really true. I see his turn earlier than when he claims it happened. But nevertheless, I think that they made him a much more devout religious person than he might have been if he had stayed a bachelor.
So Jane, you told us a little bit about the John Dickinson Writings Project. Do you have any other projects you're working on, or would you care to tell us more about your documentary editing project?
Yeah, so the John Dickinson Writings Project, it's always a challenge, but we're making progress, and we hope to have at least volume one in the hands of the press this year and published next year. And there's going to be a John Dickinson symposium as a launch event in April of 2020 in Philadelphia. It's going to be sponsored jointly by the American Philosophical Society, the Historical Society of Pennsylvania, and the Library Company of Philadelphia. And from that, we're going to have around 17 scholars presenting papers, new research on Dickinson that we're going to publish in an anthology. That should, I hope, show people what's possible in Dickinson's papers. But before that, even, I am honored that the governor of Delaware has decided that he wants to see a definitive biography of Dickinson. I'd planned this to be the last part of my trilogy on Dickinson. The first part was my book on his constitutional thought, Quaker constitutionalism, and the political thought of John Dickinson. And the second part is the complete writings and selected correspondence of John Dickinson. And then later, I was going to work on the biography. But Governor John Carney has decided that he wants the biography done sooner rather than later. So he has, with the approval of the Delaware legislature, has set aside funds to allow me to work nearly full time on the biography for the next 2 years at the end of this semester. I'll take a 2-year leave from teaching, with the exception of teaching a couple of courses, and work on the biography. So hopefully that will be out before 3 years are up. And I'm going to make this as full and historically accurate as possible. But my goal is also to make it, it should be documented like a history book, but I want it to read like a novel, to really bring his life to light and let people get to know this person who I've more or less lived with now for 20 years in my head. And I want to show people what he's like, all aspects of him, as much as we can from the record. And so that's what I'm jumping into next. And it's exciting.
What if we have more questions about John Dickinson or want to follow up on something that we talked about today? How can we reach you?
People should go to the website for the John Dickinson Writings Project. If you just Google John Dickinson Writings Project or John Dickinson and Calvert, you should find your way to the information site for the John Dickinson Writings Project. And under news and events, I try to keep my most recent articles either posted there in PDF form or links to them updated with interviews and other things that I've done. They can also follow the John Dickinson Writings Project on Facebook, where I try to keep people updated. And if anyone has specific questions that aren't addressed in the articles that I've written or the book that I've written, they should feel free to email me at jane.calvert@uky.edu. And I'm happy to answer specific questions that I haven't addressed in my writings.
Jane Calvert, thank you for helping us better understand John Dickinson.
It's been my pleasure. A lot of fun. Thank you.
John Dickinson was a man of principle, a founder who seems to have had a strong moral compass. Now, that doesn't make him perfect, but it does make him interesting to study. What made John Dickinson tick? What made his politics such that he would become the internationally famous ardent supporter of the American cause against Great Britain, someone who really advocated for the colonies in a way that inspired all types of people to action, and yet also be the person who refrained from voting for American independence and refused to sign the Declaration of Independence. From today's conversation, it seems the answers lie in John Dickinson's Quakerism. Now, as Jane noted, John Dickinson wasn't actually a Quaker. He seems to have been more of a fellow traveler who was raised by Quaker parents and married a devout Quaker woman. But these women and their Quakerism really shaped John Dickinson. Now, here's where we can see this. As Jane noted, Dickinson held strong anti-slavery beliefs. He held strong beliefs about helping the poor and downtrodden. And if we're really careful about it, we can also say that Dickinson held strong 18th century feminist views about women. Now, having 18th century feminist views didn't mean Dickinson thought that women should run for public office, but it did mean he wanted them to engage with politics and speak their minds about it. And he wanted to protect their ability to speak their minds about it even when they were in public. Now, it was because of all of these different Quaker-inspired principles that John Dickinson seems to have advocated for the American cause, tried to shape its first constitution with his draft of the Articles of Confederation, and yet also refused to vote for and sign the Declaration of Independence. In July 1776, John Dickinson didn't know what the future held for his fellow Americans. What he knew in that moment of 1776 was that Great Britain had a constitution. It was a good constitution, one that promised to protect American rights, abolish slavery, and improve the lives of the downtrodden, if only Americans could reconcile their grievances with Great Britain. This is why John Dickinson seems to have been bent on reconciliation. The protection of rights was something John Dickinson found really important, something worth fighting for. And it was his desire to protect rights that seems to be the main reason why he stood against independence in July 1776. The British Constitution was something he knew. It was something that guaranteed a protection of rights. But when the vote for independence passed, John Dickinson didn't hide from it. Instead, he took up arms and went to the front to fight for his country. Now, a point I found really interesting about our conversation with Jane is a point she made at the end, when Jane talked about and illustrated the power of history and the power of history writing. Historians rely on what we call historiography to help guide our research and frame our thinking about the past. As we learned in episode 88 with Michael McDonnell, historiography is a term that refers to the history of history writing, all of the books and articles written about past people, phenomena, and events. Now, the power of historiography can be that when one historian interprets the facts and context of the past one way, other historians may follow their lead. Historians build our knowledge of the past through a process of collaboration, and that process includes relying on the work of other historians. Now, often historical collaborations work out really well, and there are no problems. But sometimes, people make mistakes, and they may have unknowingly erred in their interpretation about something because, since the time their work was published, new sources have come to light, and the historical profession may have developed new and better methods for reading historical sources and interpreting the information they contain. And this is what Jane said happened to John Dickinson. Earlier Dickinson scholars couldn't understand Dickinson and his politics the way that Jane can, because she's had access to his writings in a way that no other scholar has had before. Now, historians are always finding misinterpretations, discovering new evidence, and working to hone how they research and interpret the past. This is a large part why historians often spend so much time in grad school. I mean, I spent 7.5 years there. And why historians spend a lot of time reading and researching in the archives. There is always new information coming to light and new ways to examine and interrogate old information. This is really important work that historians do for us. Unless we have historians out there looking at and critically eyeing the work of earlier scholars, people who were important, people who had important experiences, and people who made important contributions on the ground can be left out, forgotten, or wrongly interpreted and misunderstood in our knowledge of the past. History tells us who we are and how we came to be who we are. History does important work for us, and it's important that we get it right. Now, you can find more information about Jane, her book Quaker Constitutionalism, her documentary editing project, the John Dickinson Writings Project, plus notes for everything we talked about today on the show notes page. BenFranklinsWorld.com/258. Friends, I'll be in Atlanta next week, and I can't wait to meet up with you. Please check out the details for our meetup at BenFranklinsWorld.com/meetup and RSVP so I know to look out for you. Again, that's BenFranklinsWorld.com/meetup. Bombas is a company that makes comfortable socks and helps the homeless. Check them out and try them out for yourself. Save 20% on your first order when you shop at bombas.com/BFWorld. That's bombas.com/BFWorld to save 20%. bombas.com/BFWorld. Production assistance for this podcast comes from the Omohundro Institute's Digital Projects team. Joseph Adelman, Martha Howard, Kayla Pittman, Holly White, and Karen Wolf. Breakmaster Cylinder composed our custom theme music. Finally, I don't know about you, but I'm still mulling over the idea of how we may have had John Dickinson all wrong. I guess, for one reason or another, there really are a lot of figures that take us a long time to understand or even often to discover or recover from the past. Do you know of any other figures you think that we may have misunderstood or of people that we don't know but we should know? I'd really love to know who they are. Liz at BenFranklinsWorld.com. Ben Franklin's World is a production of the Omohundro Institute.